In Lesson 6.1, students look at a burning candle and have a discussion about whether it's a chemical reaction or not. And if it is, what are the reactants and what are the products? The question to investigate is, where do the atoms in the products of a chemical reaction come from? The big science concepts covered are, in a chemical reaction, the bonds between the atoms and the reactants are broken, the atoms rearrange, and then rebond to make the products. And the type and number of atoms in the reactants is equal to the type and number of atoms in the products, which means that in a chemical reaction, mass is conserved. So you can do a demonstration where you light a tea light candle and then talk to students about whether it's a chemical reaction or not. If it is, they're reactants that are interacting with each other and forming products. So you can talk to students about what might be the reactants and what might be the products. To give them a hint, you can put a jar on top of the lit candle and see what happens. Well, the flame will go out. So the idea is that you limited one of the reactants. If you talk to students, you can get to the idea that the wax was one reactant and something from the air was the other one, and it's oxygen in the air. Then you can show students a chemical reaction that's very similar to a burning candle. The candle is made of wax, which is paraffin, which is a hydrocarbon, which means it's made up of carbons and hydrogens. So in this case, we use a very simple hydrocarbon, methane, and show that methane plus oxygen from the air reacts to give carbon dioxide and water. That is basically the reaction of a burning candle. Instead of methane, it's paraffin, but it's still a hydrocarbon plus oxygen yields carbon dioxide and water. That's called a combustion reaction. It can be pretty surprising to students that water is formed in a combustion reaction when they're used to water being used to put out fires, but actually water vapor is formed in a combustion reaction like this. And the idea is that when we put the jar over the candle, the reaction used up all the oxygen that was in the jar and couldn't get any more, so the reaction stops and the candle goes out. But now the question is, how do these reactants become these products? Let's take a look. We have an animation that shows the methane and the oxygen on one side of the equation, and if you hit this formula for methane, the methane breaks up into the carbon and the four hydrogens, and you just do the same thing in the oxygen, and then if you click on the one of the products, you can form it here. If you click on the other one, it forms here, and this gives you the whole reaction. So in this case, students actually see that the reactants form the products. There's nothing new has come in. The same atoms that were present in the reactants broke apart, rearranged, and formed the products. So you could actually count the four hydrogens on this side of the equation and find them over here. You could count the four oxygens over here and find them over here, and the one carbon. So it's balanced and mass is conserved. On the activity sheet, students are given models on paper of the atoms for hydrogen, carbon, and oxygen. They can cut them out and use them to actually form the equation themselves and prove that the atoms in the reactants come apart, you can rearrange them to make the products. And on the reactant side, students can see how many of each reactant there is and write it down. There's one carbon, four hydrogen, and four oxygen. This equation gives a good opportunity for kids to grapple with the subscripts and coefficients and learn what they mean and see that the coefficient applies to the entire molecule and that the subscript only applies to the atom that it's connected with. Then we give students some practice where they can try some other equations, ones that have more atoms in them, but really it's the same types of atoms: methane, CH4, propane, C3H8, and butane, C4H10. So that students can see if you combine them with a certain amount of oxygen, you get a certain amount of CO2 and water as the products. And if you count up all the reactant atoms and all the product atoms, you'll see that the equations are balanced and that mass is conserved. Working with the equations also gives you a chance to talk about what really do these chemical equations mean. They really show you the ratio of molecules that react to form a ratio of products. For instance, this reaction between methane and oxygen, there'll always be two molecules of oxygen for every molecule of methane. and they'll always produce two molecules of water to one molecule of carbon dioxide. The chemical equation can give you a lot of information. It shows which atoms are involved in the molecules themselves and also the ratios in which they react. If you're in an NGSS state, there's a performance expectation, MSPS 1.5, which says, develop and use a model to describe how the total number of atoms does not change in a chemical reaction and thus mass is conserved. Well, lesson 6.1 relates to this exactly because we use models of molecules to show that the same type and number of atoms in the reactants are in the products and nothing new is produced and mass is conserved. If you look at the foundation boxes, you see that we develop and use models, which are the models of molecules made up of atoms. We show that substances react chemically in characteristic ways. In this case, methane reacts with oxygen to form carbon dioxide and water, and that the original substances are regrouped into different molecules, and that the total number of each type of atom is conserved, and thus the mass doesn't change. For this idea of cross-cutting concepts, matter is conserved because the atoms are conserved in physical and chemical processes. In this case, it's a chemical process. Thanks for watching, and good luck with the lesson.